This episode is brought to you by Thomas Cook Airlines. Fly to Seattle from Manchester on Thomas Cook Airlines at thomascookairlines.com. Nestled between ancient conifer forests, sprawling inland waterways, and imposing mountain ranges, it's hard to find a city with a more impressive surrounding than the Emerald City. Built on the backs of Nordic fishermen, industrious loggers, and hopeful gold prospectors, Seattle has long been one of the most diverse cities in America. And that diversity is not just a point of significant and understandable pride for Seattleites, it has shaped the character and culture of this city for centuries. Seattle is served by Seattle-Tacoma International Airport, almost universally known as SeaTac. Like many airports in the U.S., SeaTac has stretched and scaled inelegantly over a number of decades, but it is still one of the better U.S. airports. Located about 13 miles south of downtown Seattle, you have a number of different ways to get from SeaTac to the city.
And as you're arriving in Seattle on Air Force One, like all of you will, something very important to remember. Even if you're connecting to another flight within the U.S., you still have to go through U.S. immigration. Collect your bags and go through customs, and then at the very least, go back through security before getting on your next flight. It is what it is. It will take time, so make sure you leave enough of it. But if you are planning on sticking around in sunny Seattle, your best bet is to jump on the Link Light Rail, which will get you from the airport to Westlake Station in downtown Seattle in 37 minutes. And at just $3 a ticket, it has to be among the best value airport transport options in the country. The Link Light Rail station at the airport is connected to the main terminal via a sky bridge, which is near carousel number one when you're picking up your bags. And you can buy your ticket from one of the vending machines in the station itself.
Alternatively, a taxi will get you to downtown Seattle in about 25 minutes. But rush hour traffic can be heinous in the greater Seattle area, so that time could double on a bad day. The journey will cost around $40 to $50 US, plus tip, of course. If you're using Uber or Lyft from the airport, request your ride after you've collected your bags and head to the third floor of the airport parking garage, where you'll find the rideshare pickup zone.
Ask many Seattleites about the public transport system here, and you'll be greeted with snorts of incredulity and much rolling of eyes. But for an American city, the public transport here really isn't that bad. The city is compact and logically laid out as well, with biking and walking at its heart, so you really won't struggle to get around. Before we get into the mechanics of getting around the city, an interesting but crucial tidbit for navigating these sunny streets. The city itself is carved up into a roughly 3x3 grid with 7 directional sectors: northwest, north, northeast, east, west, southwest, and south. Street addresses are written with the directional sector before the name. So for example, East 45th Street. Whereas avenues like Beacon Avenue here have that directional sector after name. So Beacon Avenue South. A small but very important detail.
The main form of public transport in Seattle are buses run by Metro Transit. The buses are clean, modern, air-conditioned, and reasonably comfortable. The bus network serves most of the greater Seattle area, and a single ticket will cost you $2.50 at off-peak times and $2.75 during rush hour. Board the bus at the front, pay the driver with exact change, and exit from the back of the bus when you reach your destination.
Besides Metro Transit buses, there are also several other providers of bus services in the greater Seattle area, as well as the Link Light Rail, commuter rail services, and a number of ferry and water taxi companies. The only way to move seamlessly between the transit providers, and sometimes at no cost, is one of these, an Orca card, Seattle's tap-in, tap-out system. You can buy these from any of the vending machines in the stations themselves, from QFC supermarkets, or from a manned ticket booth. They cost $5 to buy, and then you top up with the value that you need. And of course, as always with these things, remember to tap in before you board. Perhaps a more unusual way to get around the Pacific Northwest, and at the very least get a unique perspective on this most photogenic of cities, is by seaplane. Kenmore Air operates scheduled flights from Lake Union here in downtown Seattle to all over the Pacific Northwest, including Vancouver and the San Juan Islands, as well as scenic flights over Seattle itself and all the way out to Mount Rainier. We rarely talk about specific tourist destinations in the show, and that's by design, but there's a place here in Seattle that feels too significant not to mention, and that's the Museum of Flight here at Boeing Field. There are not many places on Earth, in fact, there are no places on Earth, where you can walk through the very first 747 ever made, the very first 727, the very first 737, the third Dreamliner, Air Force One, Concorde, and a Blackbird. Even if you're not an airplane nerd like I am, it feels significant because without these planes, without the work that went on right here, none of us would be able to experience the cities that we showcase in this show. So for me, this is a place of pilgrimage.
It is my happy place.
But I strongly encourage you to come here as well because it's a really unique and wonderful place.
This episode is brought to you by Thomas Cook Airlines, who fly from Manchester to Seattle and many other fantastic destinations around the world. Visit thomascookairlines.com to book your summer flight to Seattle and beyond today. Spend some time at the famous Pike Place Market and you quickly understand Seattle's obsession with and passion for fresh, local, and seasonal food. But do me a favor, be sure to avoid the gum wall just below the market.
It makes me want to go take a shower.
Which is about as far from fresh as you can get. The waters surrounding Seattle provide the city, and indeed the country, with some of the highest quality seafood in the world. And one of the best places to enjoy this local fare at the absolute top of its game is the Walrus and the Carpenter.
We take it kind of seriously here.
Including local and house specialty, oysters.
The most important question, and I can't wait to hear your take on this, how are you supposed to eat them? Because I have been given instruction by people all over the world, and it is in absolutes, and they're always contradicting each other.
Gotcha.
So I'm very interested to
hear. The way that I eat my oysters is I don't put anything on them.
Okay.
I just taste them for what they are. And you kind of do the slurp it in, two chews, and then swallow is kind of what I do.
I never chew. I used to never chew, and I used to just slam them back, but now I chew them up because your saliva activates the gland that's in the oyster, and it makes them sweeter.
And the oyster du jour is Disco Hama from Discovery Bay, just 50 miles north of Seattle.
Cheers!
They're good.
That is so good.
But why are they so good?
They're filters. They're filtering the water and they're filtering everything that comes through there. So you really get the opportunity to really taste what's happening in that area. And it's fascinating. So the oyster will change and it could be cucumbery or melony, or it could be very tidal and like briny, and it's just how it's grown, where it's grown, that all matters.
Wow.
And it's what makes, I think Pacific Northwest oysters really unique, is because they have those delicate flavor profiles. And I don't want to miss that, so I don't put anything on.
Cheers.
Cheers.
But it's not just seafood here at Walrus and Carpenter. Fresh tomatoes and vanilla oil, shaved zucchini and basil oil with fresh cherries and pine nuts. Local, seasonal, and utterly delicious. But the real showstopper in these parts is this, gooey duck, an almost not safe for work clam.
This is about as Pacific Northwest
it's
as you
like
get.
It's about as like Washington as you can possibly get. So these guys we get from a local tribe out in the Hood Canal. They are about 4 pounds. They're huge gooey ducks. Most of the ones that you find farmed are much smaller. So since these are wild, they get very large. And they're about 40 to 50 years old.
Yeah, and you can only harvest them when they're that old.
The gooey duck is sliced ultra thin and served with crispy quinoa, celery, and cilantro, and served in a delicious sauce made of soaked fenugreek, jalapeno, cilantro, and lime juice.
It's pretty fun.
That sauce is something else. I think it's probably got the best ratio for ugly on the outside, delicious in the middle of anything I've ever eaten. I was doing my research for this episode, I asked a lot of people about their opinions on food in Seattle. Got a lot of recommendations. The only place that literally everybody recommended was this, Dick's. It's been here since 1954. It's open till at least 2 a.m. There's a few locations, but they're all open till at least 2 a.m. So it was pitched to me as the ultimate drunk food. The menu last changed in 1982, and that was only to accommodate the addition of Diet Coke. Other than that, it has remained the same since the early 50s. It is exactly what you would hope a drive-in would be. Great burgers, phenomenal fries, which they make in-house, milkshakes, sundaes, and sodas. And this thing is a work of art. It is exactly what you would want after a night of libations. That's really good. I'll give you, this is up there with In-N-Out. Not as good, but up there, which is saying a lot. And the fries, these are easily some of the best fries I've ever had. I can see why everybody comes here in Seattle. This is so good. And it's a proper drive-in as well. It really hasn't changed since the 50s. That's rare, and I love it. Seattle, I love this place. Well done.
There are few institutions in the world that are as universally adored by young and old. There are even fewer institutions that allow me to encourage my audience, without a hint of irony, to go eat a bag of dicks.
We're in America, so you'll be using the dollar while you're here. And while America is slowly, ever so slowly, catching up with the rest of the world's transactional norms, there are still a few anachronisms to be aware of. When you're in a bar or a restaurant and you want to pay with your credit card, the bill is brought to you, you put your card inside of the billfold, they take it away to process it, they bring it back to you, and you sign a piece of paper confirming the transaction and adding tip. More on that, unfortunately, later. In coffee shops, convenience stores, supermarkets, etc. that take card, it could go a number of ways. If you have chip and pin, you'll probably enter your card and then sign on the screen, enter your pin, sign a piece of paper, recite a Bible verse, give a fluid sample, or all of the above. In this weird transitional phase in American transactional culture, it's a little bit of a crapshoot, so good luck. I'm not gonna spend too much time talking about tipping because those of you that are good travelers know that when you're in America, you tip after a sit-down meal. Always. And those of you that refuse to do it shouldn't be traveling in the first place because you feel it's okay to ignore cultural norms you disagree with. I know, strong words, but there we are. So, we're in America, and until the whole system changes, tip or GTFO. This is a city where the costs and prices of things seem to vary wildly. You can get a life-changing burger for just over $3, but you can also pay $6 for a mediocre donut and a barely warm cup of coffee. Jesus lover, as my great-grandmother-in-law used to say. So don't be surprised if you pay $2 for a great beer with a friendly bartender or $9 for a beer a couple of blocks away. Brace yourself. And on that note, let's do the rundown. A cup of coffee at the original asterisk Starbucks will cost you around $3. And a pint of beer will cost you anything from $2 to $9. $9. And for the most reliable indicator of a nation's cost, the good old Big Mac, you're gonna pay about $5.49. Actually, exactly $5.49.
I always seem to leave Seattle with as many questions as answers. There is no denying Seattle's natural beauty and relaxed pace of life. Its spectacular surroundings, at least on the surface, are immediately attractive and obviously appealing. But this is a complicated city. Seattle is wrestling with some of the worst social inequality problems in America. And to its credit, it's tackling these problems head on. And while I may never leave with all the answers, the one certainty I have is that I will get back to this fascinating and beautiful city just as soon as I can.